I think there was much more of a sense of mission this year than in previous years. Before, a lot of people are kind of, I'd heard said, well, I've turned up because I've been given this data protection job, but I don't really know anything about it, so I'm hoping to learn something today. Whereas there was far more people saying, I know what data protection is all about now, and we've actually got something to aim for, a goal, a motivator, and I'm here to find out more about how our organisation can approach that. So the focus was very different, and I think that made a lot of impact in the benefit that people took away from the conference, because there was something, a common shared purpose, a sense of shared purpose in the rooms, and that was really valuable. I think the Elizabeth Denham's speeches were very well received among the data protection community. It's like, yes, she really gets it. She's on our side. She wants us to make this awesome, so we're going to go away and be awesome. And I also think that the approach of splitting up into three sector tracks in the afternoon, so there was a third sector track, a commercial sector track, and a public sector track, allow people to just get a little bit more specific about the issues that were important to them than had been possible in previous years. And having said that, the different tracks were all talking about the same thing, they were just approaching it in different ways. So, for example, the public sector track were quite concerned about the disappearance of legitimate interests. The third sector track were focusing quite hard on consent and direct marketing. And the commercial sector track, I understand, we're looking into things like information security as well as the direct marketing stuff as well.
Well, my perspective, in some ways, I'm not sure why I'm up here, because I was at the conference, but I was, for those of you who weren't there and haven't been before, there's a main arena where the sort of keynote speeches are delivered. There are breakout sessions in the afternoon, and Rowena spoke at one of them. And then there is the information market, which is, over the years, Ken, you'll probably know this, it's grown quite considerably, but it's where exhibitors can have stalls, and the exhibitors will be a mix of, I mean, the ICO's got a few stalls, software vendors, and interest groups, such as NABPO, such as IRMS, have stands. I was on the stand all day, didn't really manage to get away from it at all. Rowena helped at various points. So my perspective was really of hordes of people coming to talk to us. But that tells me something. It's always a bit like that, but this year it was two or three times as busy, I'd say. And what that told me and what people were telling me is how much of a need there is for support, community networking at this time. We're all in, if not in the same boat, we're all in a flotilla of boats that are all doing roughly the same thing. Some maybe are leaking a bit, some are very watertight, but we're all kind of trying to get towards the same end. And I think that's why I was really pleased when I'm talking to Claire about having this joint event, because NADPO and IRMS are different organisations, but we're great friends. Is Mike still here? Former chair of IRMS, Mike Pearce, and I some years ago decided that it would be a good idea for us to have a closer relationship. This event is the outcome of one of those things. So that was one of my main takeaways from the ICO conference. A, how damn busy it was, and I think, Ken, you can confirm 800 odd delegates? And many, many more on the waiting list, and just the sheer interest of people coming to our stall, coming to the IRMS stall. Didn't see so many going to the software vendors, which I kind of was quite pleased about, because this isn't about software, it's about a lot more than that. So those were my takeaway points.
So I have been to three conferences. I am obviously on the list that gets in. I don't know how I've managed to get to three, because it is genuinely difficult to get a place. And I met these guys in Manchester on these occasions as well. So it's a great networking opportunity to go. There was a Scottish ICO conference last year. Is that happening again?
We're planning to have one at some point this summer, but
great.
Okay. Short-staffed.
Well, I went to that one last year as well, and it was fantastic because it was after the final version of the GDPR was published, but before the Brexit vote, so everyone was still really enthusiastic about GDPR, and there was a lot of good practical discussions at that conference because there was a reason to talk about it all, and we had a great discussion about privacy impact notices, about the fines, all that sort of thing, but it was all very much developing. So I was really keen to go to Manchester this year and was rewarded by, again, a lot more detail. And obviously I talked about the consent session that I went to. The draft guidance had just been published at that stage, and the room was packed with people who really wanted to hear, not just read the guidance, but hear what was being said and get a wee bit more information about that. And so from my point of view, it was a very good year to get to the golden ticket. I love Liz Denham. I'm sure there will be areas where everyone disagrees with what she says, but she has come like a breath of fresh air to this area at exactly the right time where there's so much uncertainty. And she engages so well with our audience. She spoke at the NADPO conference, which was, I think, the end of last year, and she stayed around for most of the day simply to speak to people who are involved in the area and to get a feel for what the concerns are in terms of GDPR implementation. And that's fantastic to see, that the person at the top of the organisation, who, let's face it, we're all waiting on the guidance to come from the ICO and also from the Article 29 Working Party as well, which will assist us in our jobs going forward. But it was comforting, I think, to listen to her talking. And I can't remember who talked in the afternoon as well, but it was all about the engagement with other jurisdictions, like with the European Economic Area, or however we're going to define that, so that going forward we can see that there will be these relationships with different supervisory authorities, to give them that name effectively. And that, again, it was a really encouraging place to be and to hear that all of that work is going on in an organisation which, let's face it, is so tight on staff and resources, but they really seem to have a lot of energy about them. And that was what my impression of the conference was. I put that slide up, and I can't see it, so I've had to write down all of the issues that are there. And I think it would be quite a good time to have a discussion about any of the issues that are up there. The guidance is obviously expected, but I think that there are certain areas that are probably exercising people more than others. And you know, you've got a forum, not just us, but people in the audience who are really engaged with this topic. And I think it would be good to start some discussions in those areas. And we can feed back from the conference about what was said in those particular topics. So is there any burning issues that people want to ask about in particular? There is! Okay.
Yeah, I'm an engineer. I work for the Criminal Injuries Compensation
Okay.
We're actually an agency of the Ministry of Justice. Mm-hmm. We're really struggling to understand how our role would fit with the BPO. And we are only a small part of the Ministry of Justice. So we are kind of talking between that around a half, because we don't have a resource to employ a BPO that would be impartial, but would we be able to tax on to the Ministry of Justice, or would that be conflict? But we're really not too sure how we can run from that.
Not sure. I'm going to pass.
I don't think, and you know, I'm happy to be corrected on this. I mean, I don't think it's a case that you necessarily have to appoint someone on a full-time basis. The regulation makes clear also that it can be done on the basis of a service contract. In terms of your relationship with the Ministry of Justice, are you a separate data controller? So I guess you couldn't, well, not say you couldn't share one, but you would need someone designated specifically for yourselves. But I think, from my point of view, I don't think you have to look at it as a discrete full-time role, as long as it's clearly the person to whom it's given is clearly distinguished in terms of what they're doing.
Yeah, and there's also the guidance from Europe made it quite clear that they really want that person to be accessible to the organisation. It is acceptable that they're not an employee. It can be someone with the organisation. It can be shared as well with other organisations. But the bottom line is that's okay as long as the individual complies with all the other sort of independent and proper training, proper experience. It's there's not that many people, I think, who could properly fulfil the role. Controversial, but as long as the person is accessible to the organisation, then it doesn't have to be a full-time dedicated role, and that makes sense. There are many organisations like yours who are in the public sector who simply won't have that resource. But I think it's an important role to fill and to think about filling now, because it will drive forward what we need to do over the next year.
Without complicating the matter, we were having some discussions just around the table we're sat on. There are a number of queries in my own mind about just how the role is going to look. It's an odd idea of having someone who acts independently, who can't be dismissed for performing their functions under the regulation, who reports to the highest level of management. In some ways that sounds a great role, but there's accountability, but equally they're not responsible for the compliance of the data controllers with the regulation. I was thinking this just the other day to myself. If you appoint a data protection officer, they have to act independently. They can't receive instructions as to how to perform their task. And they will be processing personal data, sensitive personal data. That to me sounds like a data controller. So do they have to appoint a data protection officer for themselves? Now, I'm being flippant, but there are lots of things to be teased out, I think, before we're more clear on how it will actually look within an organisation. No comment. When Ken and I were talking earlier, you mentioned it in your talk. What, you know, the data protection officer for the ICO. What a role that is. You report to the information commissioner, really, and tell her what she's done wrong.
I think one thing that came out of the conference in regard to the role of the data protection officer was that it's really important that organisations understand that the data protection officer is not there to do data protection for the organisation. They're there to support, advise, enable and monitor the organisation, how the organisation itself does data protection. So on the one hand, if it all goes horribly wrong, but the data protection officer has been advising how to do it right, that's not the data protection officer's fault or problem. But on the other hand, they need to have the resources that are going to be required to do the job properly, and they need to be the right person for the role. So the organisation has to take data protection more seriously than just anointing somebody DPO and saying, right, off you go. It's got to be an integral part of business operations. And I think that realisation is starting to seep through organisations where previously it was like, oh, well, that's the data protection officer's problem. Now it's, oh my goodness, this is our problem. Let's ask the data protection officer how we should be doing it. And I think that's a real, really positive step forward.
Can I just make a comment about that particular question? As far as I can see there, you have a problem in that you're a fairly small organisation, so you probably don't require a full-time data protection officer. So if you have a part-time data protection officer, what's the rest of their time? If the rest of their time is working for you, I'd be very surprised if they could do another conflict of interest within your organisation. Mm. If it's somebody external, with the expertise they would need in your sector, if they're going to be data protection officer to someone else with that expertise, there's probably again going to be a conflict of interest, I suspect. I don't know where you go from that, but I can see it being, as you said, between a rock and a hard place. Mm. Yeah. Don't make sense.
I think that issue of having, as I said, the regulation makes clear that the DPO can be appointed on a service contract, but I think that does raise lots of questions.
Like that, I think it's a huge issue. Yeah. Maybe not in a small local authority set, well, maybe big enough to have a whole one, but many public bodies could.
Yeah. Even the issue that you and I were talking about earlier, Tim, about contractual law. Yeah. You know, if you can't dismiss a DPO for performing their functions, you know, can you terminate a contract of an externally appointed DPO? I think the answer is probably no, but I'm not a lawyer.
Sure, there'd be a way around if you had a clever lawyer.
Depending on how the contract's written, that
would be. I attended the public sector breakout session, or whatever it was called, panel session, and I think there was possibly quite a strong feeling in that one of frustration because of all the things we've highlighted today about the uncertainty, the guidance, and particularly, and I appreciate the ICO can only see that it's coming into force on that date and that's it, you know, there's no soft implementation. Mm. But for many areas, particularly within the AG sector, we work on cycles. We get students in on a cycle. So we have to be compliant by May, you know, 2018. And there's so much stuff we don't know. It won't affect all those areas. We can still work towards it the best we can do. But to say we're getting some things out in October 2017 and some things in 2018, mm-hmm. I mean, we're talking about this summer. Mm-hmm. So that, I think, there was quite a strong feeling of we're not getting much help, but we appreciate it's not much help that can be given. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, it was... I didn't get a happy feeling from that session.
It did strike me that there was a lot of people who wanted the ICO to tell them how to do stuff. And as a regulator, the ICO is supremely helpful by providing all this guidance, but at the end of the day, the law as written is fundamentally the key point. So if an organisation's waiting for guidance before they do anything about the law, then they're probably shooting themselves in the foot.
Yeah, I don't think that was what people were saying, but they're saying, you know, there's, well, for us, for example, we still don't know whether we're definitely public authority. We're working on the assumption that we are. But it's quite hard to say to your senior managers, this is going to affect a massive area of our business because we can't align legitimate interests. Is that definite? I can give you my best guess, the best guess that we all have, which is that, yes, we will be a public authority. But that's quite a hard, you know, discussion to have with senior managers about some pretty serious impacts for our organisation. And I would totally agree, people are waiting for the guidance in order to start doing anything, that's a foolish approach. But to say that you don't want to have to change whole systems, you know, in a few months' time to comply with your best case, guidance is still to come. And of course, we're just in a chicken egg scenario, and we're all in the same boat, we're all waiting, there's all these uncertainties, but I felt like there was a lot of unease in that public sector session.
Ken talked earlier about the lack of soft implementation. I am absolutely proud to be nothing to do with the Information Commissioner's Office. I have huge respect for them. If I was the Information Commissioner in June next year and an issue was raised with me, I think what I would be looking at is a few things. One is what steps has this data controller taken to comply with their legal obligations. Obviously, have they had regard to what guidance was around? But I'd also be bearing in mind that I've got discretion how to exercise my powers. And I would be thinking I'm less likely to exercise those powers in a scary way against a data controller that's done everything that it reasonably could to try to comply with what it understood to be its obligations. And I may disagree with it, and I may advise them along those lines, as I say, I'm not the information commissioner.
I think if you aim for gold standard good practice over and above the letter of the law, you're carrying much less risk about the uncertainty. So if you're, for example, if you turn out not to be a public authority, you could potentially rely on legitimate interests, but you might have found another way to do it by then. You can then review, you know, what looks to be the best thing. Obviously your privacy impact assessment on your new systems, that would be something to take into account and design the flexibility into it as far as possible. Organisations that are going to focus on, you know, what's the bare minimum we can get away with at the least expense and with least time and effort are going to should fear uncertainty more than those who go, we're going to be just awesome at all of this because we want to be.
I mean, if I can go back to the way we look at enforcement just now, particularly on the fines, we look at the case, we look at the mitigating factors, we look at the aggravating factors. I can't see us changing our general approach to enforcement post May 2018. It will, of course, be in the framework that we're waiting for from Article 29, and you can see that we're suffering a degree of frustration as well. They've got to get an agreement between 28 or 27 and a half member states. So that's going to be a slow process. But I think I got a similar message. I think I said a similar message as John in my own talk. You know, get yourself as prepared as you can be. Don't wait until April of next year thinking, well, there'll be all the guidance then and we'll fit it in a month. Get going now, keep working at it. As guidance comes out, review what you've done, see what you have to modify. Yeah. And we'll hopefully get some clarity on your public sector status at some point.
I think the session that I was at about consent, you know, the guys who have published that guidance, they recognise it's going to be difficult. And I think exactly that. The women who were speaking were frustrated that they didn't have guidance from Europe yet and frustrated that they thought they might have to change the guidance. But for those of you who've read it, the language of the regulation is quite clear, and I think the guidance reflects that. It's obvious that the ICO is frustrated at the lack of guidance, but certainly thinking about it now is the only way that you can start to make sure you are as ready as you can be by May. I totally sympathise, though, with the buy-in from management. That's difficult. 20 million euros, just say that a lot.
Just following on from something that Laura said there, I mean, much of it is very, very specific in the regulation, and the guidance is putting it into plain English from obscure Europeanese with a few bits of few examples as well. But I'll leave her to do the promotion of a legal firm. You know, most of it is there. It's probably more the derogated parts that we need some clarification on and interpretation of the specifics of what is laid out in regulation.
Despite all the encouraging words, just to go back to the kind of doomsday scenario, a couple of things. Bear in mind, of course, it's 20 million or 4% of your global turnover, whichever's higher. I work for an organisation where we've calculated that's £240 million. But also, bear in mind, there is another, if you like, financial risk, and that's the risk of litigation. There is a case wending its way to the High Court. I think it's listed for trial in October. I don't know if you know, Laura, but Morrison's, who had, I think, a former employee. I can't remember what, but I think he I don't know the facts. But
100,000 He was employed by Morrison's at the time. I'm not sure in what capacity, but he was angry at them because he'd been disciplined. So he posted the personal details, including financial details, of 100,000 employees of Morrison's on a website, and there was a kind of fraudulent thing because he ended up in prison for 8 years. Morrison's is now being sued for breaching the rights of their employees under the Data Protection Act and their right to privacy, I'm assuming a common law thing as well, because they'll have clever lawyers. I think it's about 6,000 of the employees are suing Morrison's, and it's a class action, which is not something that the UK is particularly familiar with or comfortable with. It's a very American concept, but it's been classed as a class action, and the regulation specifically allows for class actions. So, as you know, I was in court yesterday with this data breach case. There was another one that we acted in prior to Christmas. They're coming across my desk thick and fast. And so, aside from the scary fines, the compensation claims are the new slips and trips or the new PPI claims. But everyone's going to be much, much more aware of their rights, possibly thanks to the lady who did a pee-pee on a golf course.
And that's it. We're talking about generally low-value claims, but you put 6,000 low-value claims together, and that can be an absolutely huge financial liability. So if you want another stick to wield over your senior management, that's actually quite a useful one that they may not be fully aware of.
And if you want a carrot as well, bear in mind that if you can avoid annoying people enough that they want to complain to the regulator or take you to court, then what you're talking about is good customer service. And that's basically the core of the GDPR, is, you know, good data, used properly, no surprises, not upsetting people. If you can focus efforts on not upsetting people and doing good customer service, then not only are you more likely to avoid getting into trouble, but actually you'll have a better reputation and then hopefully more money to be able to do the things that you need to do. So extolling the benefits of GDPR and looking at it from a risk management point of view, you know, if the risk is getting into trouble, how do you avoid getting into trouble? If you avoid getting into trouble, it may not matter that your paperwork isn't in absolutely 100% beautiful, accountable records, tip-top order, because you've done the bits that makes it a kind of moot point. You haven't upset anybody as far as you can. Obviously, for public authorities, you don't necessarily have quite so much choice about upsetting people for their own good. But as far as you can, that's definitely a work stream to focus on and a way to sell to senior management why this stuff is important and good.
If this is the new PPI law, are we going to be subject to spam texts and phone calls? Our data protection rights have been
That would be so ironic. I love that.
But just quickly on that subject, because some of you may be aware of the case, Court of Appeal case, Vidal Hall versus Google, which, based, cut a long story short, allowed people to claim under DPA solely for distress caused by a contravention of the Act. When that judgment came out, a few people were, including me, were predicting a flood of claims, a flood of low-value claims, some of them in terms of group litigation. I was speaking to a lawyer, not Laura, a London-based lawyer. I do have other lawyer friends. And I was saying, what's happened to all these? And he said, well, you don't hear about them, because they get settled, or they drop away, but they are happening. They're happening at a low level, and the Morrison's case is just the high level.
Yeah. No, actually, somebody who makes a living while doing a master's simply by taking organisations to small claims court for breaching various parts of the Data Protection Act, he makes a very comfortable living. And in each case, the organisation is bang to rights and deserve the slapping they would have got had they not decided to settle. So it is definitely happening, and if you're in need of an additional revenue stream, I'm sure there will be lawyers who are willing to help.
I'm My role is very much engagement, front ends, learning with our staff, of which across the Glasgow family we have over 30,000. So we have got a mass job in our hands to make sure that, our organisation is embedded in all those that comes with GDPR to the entire organisation. But I'm sitting here today and I can't help feeling that there is mass duplication underway just now. And my question to Ken is, are there any opportunity, a platform, where we could get some standards? Some standards in terms of leaflets, posters, you know, just what we spoke about today, rather than every one of our public organisations going away and doing it yourself.
I'm trying to do the same with 38,000 staff, so I wonder if it's one for Ken to answer. But.
Well, I don't know of one particular organisation or place to do that, but we've just done something on the health side, I think it was, with posters that you can download. Whether or not we'll continue to do that with other sectors, I don't know, but I don't put it to our comms.
It could be the equivalent of the health and safety poster, you know, that one that no one reads. but we could make it really funky. Yeah, I'm good. I'm on it.
Yeah,
with Rina.
Yeah,
because you're
use pirates.
Good ideas. Pirates will
pirates, go down
pirates will feature. Yeah, probably in Lego.
Yeah. I heard a few trainers talking about sector codes of practice, and you know we should all be signing up to, you know, a public sector code of practice or some other sectors.
The regulation does cover codes of practice, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm.
It's not an area of part of the regulation I've read in great detail.
It does suggest they would come from a representative body.
Yeah.
So if you have a representative body for public sector organisations, then they could create that, get it approved, and then adherence to it would demonstrate adherence to GDPR, more or less.
A lot like the fundraising regulators, fundraising code of practice, and the data protection advice on that.
But it's not a soft option, it's auditable and all the rest of it.
Any more questions? Okay. Any more comments, observations from the panel?
No.
ICO experience? Again, thanks very much, panel, for sharing those thoughts and experiences.